Welcome to our worship service at Mount Zion, inside, outside, and online. It is our hope that you find inspiration and joy in your time with us. The announcements are on the last page of a bulletin, and we hope you will worship soon with us again. Let's start with confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who journeys with us these 40 days and sustains us with the gift of grace. Amen. Let us acknowledge before God and one another our need for repentance and God's mercy. Holy God, we confess to you our faults and failings. Too often we neglect and do not trust your holy word. We take for ourselves instead of giving to others. We spoil rather than steward your creation. We cause hurt through the cause to heal. We choose fear over compassion. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us as we seek to follow in your way of life. Amen. Hear the good news. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son so that all may receive life. This promise is for you. God embraces with the divine mercy, forgives you in Christ's name, and revives you in the Spirit's power. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
We'll read the Kyrie responsibly. In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray. Lord God, our strength, the struggle between good and evil rages within and around us, and the devil and all the forces that defy you tempt us with empty promises. Keep us steadfast in your word, and when we fall, raise us again and restore us through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The first reading is from Genesis chapter 2. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to till it and keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, "You may freely eat of every tree in the garden, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat of it you shall die." But the serpent was more crafty than any other wild animal the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God say you shall not eat from any tree in the garden?" The woman said to the serpent, "You may eat of the tree, eat of the fruit of the tree from the garden. But God said, you shall not eat of the fruit of the tree that is in the middle of the garden, nor shall you touch it, or you shall die." But the serpent said to the woman, "You will not die, for God knows that when you eat it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to the eyes, and the tree was to be desired to make one wise, she took its fruit and ate, and she also gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate. And the eyes of both were opened, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made loincloths for themselves. We'll read Psalm 32 responsibly. Happy are they whose transgressions are forgiven, and whose sins put away.
Happy are they to whom the Lord imputes no guilt, and in whose spirit there is no guile.
Well, I held my tongue, my bones withered away, because of my groaning all day long.
For
sin came into the world through one man, for death came from sin. So death spread to all because all have sinned. Sin was indeed in the world before the law, but sin is not reckoned when there is no law. It then exercised dominion from Adam to Moses, even over those whose sins were not like the transgression of Adam, who is a type of the one who has come, who was to come. But the free gift is not like a trespass. For if the many died for one man's trespass, much more surely have the grace of God and the free gift and the grace of the one man, Jesus Christ, abounded for the many. And the free gift is not like the effect of one man's sin. For the judgment following one trespass brought condemnation, but the free gift following many trespasses brings justification. But because of the one man's trespass, death exercised dominion through that one. Much more surely will those who receive the abundance of grace and the free gift of righteousness exercise dominion and life through the one man, Jesus Christ. Therefore, just as one man's trespass led to the condemnation for all, so one man's act of righteousness leads to justification and life for all. But just as by the one man's disobedience, the many were made sinners, so by the one man's obedience, the many will be made righteous. So that
led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. He fasted 40 days and 40 nights, and afterwards he was famished. The tempter came and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread." But he answered, "It is written, one does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God." And then the devil took him to the holy city and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, "You are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear him up, so that you will not dash your foot against a stone." Jesus said to him, "Again it is written, do not put the Lord your God to the test." Again the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. And he said to him, "All these I will give you if you will fall down and worship me." Jesus said to him, "Away with you, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him." Then the devil left him, and suddenly angels came and waited on him. Here ends the gospel. Okay, I see a couple kids here today. You want to come on up for a children's sermon? A couple, I guess there's three of you, right? Okay, come on up. I'm going to tempt you. Come on up. Do this, do that, when he does it, do this, do that. You know, Jesus said, on the dining table, there was a big bowl of candy. She loved candy. Yeah, chocolate is special. But anyway, let's say this.
Chocolate.
Let's did that once too. Anyway, all chocolate on the table, okay? And Mom said, Mary, that's for later, after dinner. Don't eat it. Now, Mary said, okay. And Mom said, no, don't. And guess what? It was wrapped. She went ahead and unwrapped it, but still, man, don't eat it. She thought, okay. So Mary's mom left. Mary was looking around there, playing around the kitchen. She's looking at the candy thing. It was so tempting. Mm. You know, went over to it and she took a piece of help eating. No, but she said I couldn't have any, but let me see it. Move it around so no, yeah. I would never do that with you. I'm not saying. Well, we will get in trouble, but guess what? I'll come back. I get in trouble. Anyway, we'll come back to that. So anyway, Mary put it back. And she was tempted, but she didn't push. In her head, she thought, you know what? It might really bother me later. And I'll get it. But this is the thing. This is the thing she did, by the way. That story ends happening. But we do have to remember that sometimes we are tempted to do things. And once in a while, we're going to give in. You know, but if you do, and you feel terrible, and you ask God to forgive you, and that's called grace, and that's what's really wonderful. But you have to remember that you just have to try to resist that temptation, and we know right or wrong, it's tough sometimes, right? Yeah, right. So, these are kind of tempting, aren't they? Yeah, you know, they're just going to sit here for a minute anyway, okay? Could you hold your hands and say a prayer for me? Would you? Dear Father in heaven, we are thankful for your holy word. Help us to learn and study what it teaches so we're able to resist temptation just as Jesus did. In his name we pray. Amen. All right, now, how about this? I'll let you take something from my basket. That's okay. It's not giving into temptation because it's okay, but here comes the tough part. Maybe you could say it for everyone. That's up to you. Okay. All right, there you go. Yeah. And they are not real dogs. They're cinnamon.
Yummy.
You either can get salty or sweet. Which do you want?
I want sweet.
So then that's that. You want salty. How about you? Oh, that's it. Just two arms. Is that it? Well, you know what? Mr. Rick was eyeing these earlier. Should we let him have one? Oh, or should we just tempt him? All right. All right, you're welcome.
He was eyeing when I put it in. Talk about temptation.
Okay, thanks, guys. Okay. Don't kick any more, Rick. Doesn't wear tights. That's kind of a crazy overview title, I think. But anyway, here we go. No one believes in the existence of the devil these days, do they? Do you? Well, perhaps we can thank Hollywood and the Halloween's marketing blitz for our casual, if not incredulous, approach to the devil's existence. Pointy horns, pitchforks, red costumes. The box office ticket sales continue to shape our culture's collective consciousness of the devil. Those of us who grew up in the late 60s and early 70s remember movies like Rosemary's Baby in 1968, The Exorcist in 1973, The Omen in 1976, and the Amityville Horror in 1979. Back then, Satan's trendiness was viewed as a response to the era's social change. Oh, I just thought of one, and I thought, this isn't a horror, but I don't know if anybody remembers Flip Wilson's comedy routine. He said, the devil made you do it. whole thing, and it was pretty funny, but that was not harder, that was common, but still, there you go, it's in our culture. So, these films, or whatever, may be scary to watch or funny, but they do nothing to communicate the true terror of an honest-to-God encounter with the devil's power. This Lent, we are called to expunge the fantastical images of the devil from our minds and think seriously about the real presence of evil in our world. We know firsthand about the sin that causes, and will cause suffering to us, to our loved ones, to our neighbors, our global communities, and to creation itself. Sin is real. Suffering is real. Evil is real. Indeed, the devil is real. This oppressive, tangible reality is as real as the air we breathe. Felt, but not on the scene. Greed, envy, rage, hatred, war, discrimination, and apathy are just some of the ways the devil's forces wreak havoc upon us. And these forces have one goal and one goal only, to turn us away from the will of God. How are we to handle the good and evil forces around our everyday lives? I don't know about you, but a little true confession here. I used to always think that one was on one shoulder and one was on the other, devil and angel. And, you know, in daily life, I'd be tempted by stuff, and this guy would be going, oh, no, I do it. Eat that, and do this. And this one's like, oh, no, you don't. Don't you do that. And they're, you know, right from wrong, talking to me, kind of. Don't walk me up, please. I'm not. But help me. You know, I think, should I do this? And then I'm gonna take that now because I'm over anything. Oh no, you shouldn't do that. So yeah, I maybe a little bit now, once in a while. But anyway, I hope I'm older and remembering right from wrong better than I was when I was younger. But again, don't want me up, please. Anyway, back in Taylor Swift's time, which is now, she may have just given us all some good advice. In the spring of 2022, the pop star addressed graduates at the New York University. She said, decide what is yours to hold. That's what she urged them. And let go of the rest. Oftentimes, the good things in our lives are lighter anyway. What can we hold on to? Jesus. As we heard in verse 10 of our gospel reading, says, worship the Lord your God and serve only him. Now, there was something else that I came across when I was reading over this today, or the other day when I was preparing. Think about it as we pray the Lord's Prayer every service. You know, we say it and we know it and we try to think about the words, but remember, and today when you're doing it, there's a line in there that says, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. I mean, we've said that since we were, could talk probably, and learned the Lord's Prayer, but every time we said it, that's a verse in there. And you know, how many times do we say it and don't even think about what it really is telling us? But lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. So we're saying, okay, try not to be tempted, but if you are, you know, maybe deliver us from that evil. It might change its meaning or make you think about it in a different way. Okay, that came to me. And then another thing was, long, long ago, I had a book called The Positive Thinkers, The Guide to Handling Tough Problems. Someone gave it to me. As we all know, there's tough problems everywhere. It was by Norman Vincent Peale, who was way popular. In fact, I think this book is in the copyright, it had Roman numerals. So I had to think back. What is NCM? It was 1985. I was right. I did look it up to check it there, so I told you the truth. But anyway, back then, this book was handling tough problems, and it would give a scenario, and then he would give some Bible verses and address it. Well, of course, one of the topics in there was temptation. A good one. So what it said was, of course, we all how strong that temptation is, it's not beyond your strength. Read your Bible verses. 1 Corinthians 10:13. Just happen to have it here. And it says, no temptation has overtaken you that is not common to man. God is faithful, and he will not let you be tempted beyond your strength. But with the temptation, he will also provide you for a way of escape that you may be able to endure. So it doesn't assure that temptation isn't going to be in front of us. We're all going to face it. We do many times, not just with food. That's my temptation. But you can overcome it. He won't allow any temptation to attack you that you're not able to hold in some way. And again, like I told the kids, we're not perfect. None of us are. And so we're going to not be able to resist sometimes, but just then say, okay, I'm sorry. I shouldn't have done it. And by God's grace, he does forgive us. Now, Matthew's gospel reoriented us to the truth of the devil's power and calls us to name Satan's presences in the world. In the wilderness, Jesus encountered evil as real as its opposite, which is resurrection. This great tempter seeks to undermine Jesus' mission before he even begins. Testimony that evil has much to fear of our Jesus. Nonetheless, Jesus will not be dissuaded. Away with you, Satan, he proclaims. Thus the Lenten journey begins. A journey that takes us to the cross where the devil is named and crushed underfoot. Amen. Please join us in singing hymn number 657 in your blue hymnal, The Glory of These 40 Days. And we will sing all the verses. Four verses, I believe there are. Four verses. Thank you. Thank you. sustained by God's abundant mercy, let us pray through the church, the world, and all of creation. Our prayers to you, O God, trusting in your steadfast love and your promise to renew your whole creation through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior, Jesus Christ. You call your people to cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Paschal Feast, that, renewed in the gift of baptism, we may come to the fullness of your grace. And so, with the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Please make sure you have your communion kits, and they have been consecrated by Pastor Debbie prior to our service. So we'll continue. If you don't have them, they're in the bucket or the bowl back in the back, and I think they have some in fellowship hall if you're out there. When our congregation gathered in the celebration of Holy Communion, we heard again the story of God's mighty acts and of the love shown us in the death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. With God's mighty acts and the love shown us in the death and resurrection, of Lord Jesus Christ, with thanksgiving, we remembered that in the night he was betrayed, he took bread and gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." We were given assurance of our Lord's presence through the gift of his Holy Spirit. Now this same bread of life and the same cup of blessing is given to you, that you may be strengthened through your participation in the body of Christ. Amen. And now let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, for strength in the wilderness. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world.
Have mercy on us and grant us peace.
And now the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, given and shed for you. You may consume your communion now during the hymn of meditation, or you may do it at home. And now God, the giver of love, Christ, the resurrection and the life, and the Holy Spirit of rebirth, bless you in this Lenten journey.
Amen.
Please join us for hymn number 343 in the green hymnal, Guide Me Ever, Great Redeemer.
Thank you.